Yes, we have seen the analysis part.
Oh, I've got to ask you, do you want to be recorded?
Yes.
Oh.
So, we have seen about the analysis part and the design part. So, we'll design a wall, it's good, but we have to know how it fails. How it fails, and we have to know how it behaves while it fails. So, in order to know all the stuff, we are going to hear this PPT with lot of interest and carefully we have to hear. So, what do shear walls do? As said by Alex and Hope, they transfer the where the diaphragm transfers the forces to the shear walls, and this shear walls carries the forces to the basement. And where these shear walls either might be solid or perforated. So when they are perforated, they consist of piers and spandrels. Piers are the vertical members and spandrels are the horizontal members. And while coming to the behavior and how to analyze the behavior, solid is much more easier than the perforated one. So let's go into unreinforced shear walls. Whereas unreinforced shear walls are brittle in nature, and they lose their capacity very rapidly, and they show limited deformations after reaching the ultimate load. Okay, these are the various type of deformations they may undergo based on the axial force and the shear force acting on them. We'll go through them one by one so that you will understand much better when we go to multi-storied reinforced or reinforced or unreinforced walls. This is the tension controlled failure. This is the first mode of failure, which is caused when the shear force is much more higher than the axial force. When the axial force is less and the shear force is more, that causes the building to overturn, which causes the toe crushing at the bottom of the wall, where here is the negative side of the compression force. When we plot a graph for stress, compression stress and the shear stress in the x-axis and y-axis, there is a negative compression force which is acting on the wall, and there is a shear force acting which causes the wall to overturn. And this is the next mode of failure, that is sliding failure. When the axial force gradually increases from the point B to C, and whereas the shear stress also increases, the overturning stops and it has its weight to retain it, but the bond strength between the brick and the mortar gets away, means will be gone, so that the shear force exceeds the shear friction between the mortar and unit, which causes this type of failure, where when we plot a straight line between B and C, you will get the coefficient of friction of this bond mortar. Diagonal tension failure. As the axial stress, the compression and shear stress gradually increases, which causes the principal stresses to orient in such a way in different directions in between the mortar and the brick, which causes the tension in different directions, which causes the diagonal compression failure. Where we see here, the diagonal compression failure is the failure which is taking much shear stress than any of the other failure. So if you are going to design something, this is going to fail, it should fail in diagonal failure. Okay? As the axial stress much more increases and the shear stress when compared, it will be very less. The axial stress will cause the brick to fail in compression. This is how it happens. Now, we have seen the different types of failures, right? So we have to see how much energy is dissipated for the different type of failure, or how much it's going to take and how much is the deformations. So when we plot the graph which were done for a cyclic loading, where the graph is a drift ratio, drift percentage and the force. As the force increases, the drift also increases in the rocking mode. When the force is taken back, the drift has gone to zero as a similar time. So, we can say the energy dissipated in this is very less. How can I say that? The area of the hysteresis graph tells me how much of the energy it has been absorbed. So, what do you think? More energy should be dissipated or less energy should be dissipated? Who will vote for the first one? More energy for the second one? Just guess. Okay, second one or the first one? Second, less energy should be dissipated. Is that what? Okay.
That's my guess.
Okay. If let us think, a force is applied on me. If I dissipate less amount of energy, I'll fall down right here. If I'm standing like this, I'm dissipating my energy, means I'm distributing it or I'm damping the energy which I'm getting. So I am able to take more energy, right? So in the second mode of failure, diagonal tension mode of failure, which we can see the more area, where the more more energy is dissipated, which can take more load at the more stresses. Okay, this is the shear slip. This is the graph drawn when it is shear slip of failure. Okay, going into the multi-story unreinforced walls, when it is tested in the full scale, we are going to observe what are the types of the cracks in the walls. So mainly we are going to see about the wall 1 and wall 2. In the wall 1 is a long wall with less openings, and in the wall 2 there is a pier and a large opening in the bottom. And wall A and wall B, those are just the axis of flanges for wall 1 and wall 2, which transfers the forces to wall 1 and wall 2. We are not going to observe what is the type of failure in wall A and wall B. So in wall 1 and wall 2, we can see that wall 2 has a pier which has been which the failure is rocking mode. Rocking mode means less energy of dissipated, right? Right? In the wall 2, there is a shear slip behavior, means more energy when compared to rocking mode, right? So which wall has a greater capacity, wall 1 or wall 2? Who will vote for wall 1? Which wall has a greater capacity? Wall 1 is the first option,
two.
Or wall 2?
Yeah,
wall 1 has a greater capacity than wall 1.
Wall
1 has a greater capacity because the more energy is dissipated. When we see in the previous graph, here in the rocking mode, the energy and the force at 4 kips, it has started failed. It failed. Whereas coming to the diagonal tension mode, it has taken 10 kips. Right? So, we have done with the unreinforced part. We'll go to reinforced part. Why we have to reinforce the shear walls? Why? Means we have, in order to increase the shear capacity, the tension capacity, the compression, and the ductility mode. Why ductility? Why ductility means it shows the clear cracking pattern before it fails. How do the reinforced shear walls fail? Is either one of the four failures we have seen, or the flexure failure mode, or shear failure mode? Okay. When this depends upon the amount of reinforcement and the distribution of the reinforcement, and whether it is loaded axially or not. Whether it is geometrical, the place of the location of the wall and all the stuff. Okay, now we are going to see when it is actually loaded and when it is not actually loaded. What is the type of the values that it can obtain? When it is actually loaded, there is a delay in the first beginning of the flexural crack and the yield also. When compared to non-actually loaded, they yielded before and the cracks appeared before. So what is... We can say the axial load, when there is an axial load, it is increasing the shear and flexural capacity of the wall. Okay? And in the shear, when going into the flexural and shear failure, what are the type of stages it undergoes? Is first is the flexural crack in the bed joint is the same, but not the values. It's the type of the crack, the failure is a crack. And the second is yielding of the vertical reinforcement. The same, but it is going to fail under toe crushing. Flexure failure is due to, when it is going to fail in flexure mode, the toe crushing is going to happen, whereas in the shear mode, the diagonal crack is going to happen. Okay? And we talked about when it is actually loaded or not loaded. But now we'll talk about the percentage of steel and how it is to be distributed for a better and best performance. So when the reinforcement is provided with a equal distribution than the concentrated distribution at the edges. It gave a better performance, like 170 psi. Whereas adequate horizontal reinforcement have shown in the test with the clear cracking patterns and shear strength and ductility, where ductility is the failure mode when proper horizontal reinforcement is placed. And conversely is that less ductility when the horizontal reinforcement is less. So it not only depends upon the reinforcement, but also the lateral confinements, the compression strength, and the lateral tie supports and anchors for the shear reinforcement also depends which type of failure and how much ductility is going to show. So various types of walls now. The various types of walls are T-flange walls we are going to test. So when we test T-flange walls, when we apply a force from this side, the web is going to be in compression. When we are going to apply force in this direction, where the flange is going to be in compression, right? So when the hysteresis graph was drawn, this is the graph shows the web bit compression and flange in compression. So when the flange is in compression, it is showing much more higher dissipation of the energy and higher strength than the web bit compression. And it also says that lower compression zone in flange with less tensile reinforcement resulted in less stiffness. Even the flange is also in compression, but it shows less stiffness and less strength when its reinforcement is less. So reinforcement is linked with the amount of stiffness and strength. Okay, we have read about reinforced solid walls, T walls, and now we'll see about partially grouted or fully grouted walls. When it is fully grouted walls, the plastic hinge can occur. Means the plastic hinge is where the ultimate load comes into the picture, where the ultimate load is much more higher when compared to partially grouted. So this plastic hinge formation is required to get higher strengths. Why we require higher strength is when we are going to use them in the seismic zones. So for a less seismic zone areas, we can save lot of amount by using partially grouted walls. Now, reinforced walls with openings. We have read with unreinforced wall with openings with that testing and walls 1, wall A. Now, this is going to be this is going to tell us how much is the force that it can withstand when the reinforced walls are with openings. So, the more are the openings, the less is the ultimate load. It is around 50%. There is a drop of 50% when the size of the opening is more. And we can see the hysteresis graph. Depending upon the unsymmetrical opening, there is an unsymmetrical hysteresis graph. Okay. And while testing they have provided the constant reinforcement in the piers and spandrels, and they have tested where the solid wall have given a highest load bearing capacity with a less drifting angle, whereas the higher the bigger the opening, it showed a larger drifting angle with a less load bearing capacity. So last but one, we are going to complete this. And multi-story reinforced shear walls. In this kind of analysis and behavior of multi-story reinforced shear walls, it is much more easier to do analysis for a cantilever wall with joints, with linked joints which are slabs, rather than perforated shear walls. See, cantilever shear walls show a higher ductility. Okay. Cantilever shear walls are easy to analyze and shows a much more higher ductility when compared to perforated shear walls. So when perforated shear walls come into picture, how they fail is they may fail, the piers may fail, or the spandrels may fail. When the piers fail, we can keep much more extra reinforcement, as Hope said, in order to get transfer the complete load without any cracking or compression in the piers. But coming to the spandrels, they are having a less depth to span ratio. In order to satisfy the high ductility. So we are going to use movement joints. What are the movement joints? Means they doesn't link this cantilever. Okay. this pier and this pier much means they provide a gap which allows the movement, which allows the ductility to be performed individually by these cantilever walls, which makes these reinforced multi-story shear walls to perform better. Thank you.